Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, WrestleZone would like to welcome you to tonight's live event. Before we begin, please be advised that all WrestleZone stars are professionally trained, so please do not copy or imitate anything you see here tonight. Please also be aware that WrestleZone is proud to provide entertainment suitable for all ages, and we ask that you refrain from using any inappropriate language this evening.
I know it's a banger, but come on.
Welcome to the WrestleZone podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I'm here to let you know what's happening in the world of WrestleZone Scotland, up in the northeast of Scotland, most months, here on the Scottish Wrestling Network. We've got a show coming up this weekend, and I'm so excited to speak about it. We're going to Inverurie at the Hopeville, I think that's what it is, Hopeville Social Club. I'll find it. It's on Google Maps. And we're going to see a big show. This is the prelude before Halloween hijinks coming up on the 21st of October. So I'm ecstatic, excited. I want to talk about this because I'm going to the event itself. And I will be at Halloween hijinks as well. So we'll have a recap of this show, probably the Monday or Tuesday after this event. And then we'll have the same again for Halloween hijinks. Along with that, we will also have an SWN podcast road trip episode about this particular show. Now, the through line of this, we're going to go through the whole card. We're going to go through it all for you. But these shows are a lot of fun. These are the littler shows, I suppose you could say, for WrestleZone, when you've got your big four or five. You've got your Regal Rumble, Aberdeen Anarchy, Battle of the Nations, Halloween Hijinks, Christmas Chaos. And I suppose you could throw in a Station Hotel Showdown in there as well. This is the runoff from Battle of the Nations, where a lot happened. If you've watched our recap, you'll know what happened. If you watched our podcast episode about Battle of the Nations, we had a big chat about it, me and Kelly. We had a big chat about the event itself and all the things that are going on and all the stories that are coming through that show. And this is where the fallout really begins for this event. So I would like to tell you that you can get your tickets from Ringside World. I'd love to tell you that, but the show is sold out. It's sold out, but if you go onto WrestleZone Scotland's social media, there will be links, or if you find WrestleZone Scotland, I'll try and put links in the description, etc., etc. There may be some available tickets, just one or two that come up available due to whatever reason, whether people who've bought a ticket can no longer attend the event, contact the page, and the guys at WrestleZone have put up that there is one ticket remaining, there's two tickets remaining. So go on to social media, on Facebook specifically, and you can possibly get yourself a ticket if you haven't already. But if you haven't, why not? Because when you're looking up and down at this show card, like I say, it's a quote-unquote smaller show, but it's absolutely packed to the gills with matches. You've got your VIP pre-show, and you've got your six matches on the main card itself. It's sold out. Hopeville Social Club, I'll say it right that time. Let's just get into it. We kick off this preview with the pre-show match, which was the last match announced yesterday. It's a triple threat, which I am absolutely buzzing for. As all these matches, I'm so excited for. It's Oliver Green, Tommy Raiden, and Connor Malloy. Now, the interesting dynamic in this one is they're all fan favorites. Everyone likes Tommy. Everyone likes Connor. Everyone likes Ollie Green. So you're going to go into this thinking, well, someone's going to have to be the aggressor. Someone's going to have to show what they could do and take advantage of situations. And who is it going to be? That's the key here. When I was trying to think what the pre-show match would be after the other six matches were announced, I was thinking, oh, okay, probably Tommy and Ollie, maybe one-on-one. And I absolutely forgot Connor, which is a terrible thing to say because Connor is probably one of the best young wrestlers in the country right now. So I should never forget the name of Connor Malloy. Connor is in the VIP ticket holder match, which is the pre-show, and he's still got that opportunity in hand. At Battle of the Nations, he was a successful challenger for the tag team titles. Ollie and Tommy were unsuccessful in their pre-show match against the Outfit, where they got absolutely decimated by Ted O'Keefe, Dino, and Murphy. So they're all three are looking to bounce back, with Connor specifically looking to try and get some momentum so he can cash in his title opportunity they won at Aberdeen Anarchy. So there's a lot going on here, a lot of opportunities, a lot of things that could come from this particular kind of match. So was it £3 extra to get into the VIP? Most people go for the VIP option so they can get to see the extra match. It's always worthwhile. I haven't seen a bad VIP match yet. And I've been to quite a few WrestleZone shows now, especially in the last 2 years. So it's definitely going to be worth watching. It's going to be a lot of athleticism. I'm very intrigued to see who will be the aggressor. Like I say, who will be the guy that takes the reins of the match and tries to turn it into his favor. It could just be three guys that go out there to showcase themselves to in front of management. So Mr. P will have a look at them and go, maybe they deserve a spot on the main show. Maybe they deserve a title shot. Like I said, Connor's got that title shot in hand. We still don't know what title he'll go for, whether it'll be tag team titles with someone, whether it'll be the Tri-Counties, whether it'll be the Undisputed Championship. That's unknown. That's still the unknown factor in this, but he still has that opportunity in his back pocket. But like we saw at Battle of Nations, there's no harm in him challenging for other titles along the way if he earns the opportunity to do so, like he did with the tag team titles at Battle of Nations, the one successful. So, yeah, that's, as with every match I'm going to speak about tonight, there's so much interest, intrigue in every single match that of possibilities of where it could go next, where we can see these three go. from this particular match. Like Ollie and Tommy, they've been teaming a little bit in galas and on shows as well. So maybe they're just looking to feel each other out and maybe get a taste of what they can do individually, and maybe just go back to being a team in the end. But that's the unknown quantity of these kind of matches. Triple threats are notoriously difficult because you got to get one guy in the ring. It's not like a fatal four-way where two could be distracted on the outside with each other and then it leaves two in the ring. There's always going to be that third person on milling about, whether on the outside or in the ring, that you've got to take into account when you're in a triple threat match. So Connor has the experience advantage. He's got the title credentials as well, being a former tag team champion and having that title opportunity, that ladder match win at Abu Dhabi, a match that also involved Tommy Raiden. So he's got the experience edge, but that means nothing in a triple threat, unfortunately. He may have a little bit more experience, so he may be able to read the ring a little bit better, read the match a little bit better, but that doesn't mean that he'll be there for the deciding fall if he gets taken out by Ollie and Tommy early on. So that's what makes it interesting. So let's look at the rest of the main show. Start of the episode, this will be quite a visual heavy episode of the WrestleZone podcast. Right back at the start, we showed pretty much the majority of the matches that are happening on the show. Half of the main show matches that are happening on the show stemmed from that particular moment that you saw there, which was Foundation of the Future retaining tag team championships and then just calling out all the tag teams in WrestleZone. And one team did not take too kindly to it, and that was the outfit. They weren't happy. They didn't want to be disrespected any more than they had to be. And they came out and had a showdown with Bruiser Brad Evans and Ryan Riley. And this stems three of the matches that are on the show. So I don't know how I'm still formulating the plans in my brain while we're recording here. I'm still figuring out how to break down each match because it's probably, if you were dissecting the matchups you'd put these two teams into, Dino Murphy, Ted O'Keefe, as Bruiser Brad Evans, Ryan Riley, and Zach Dynamite, this would be your matchups. This would be your equivalents, I suppose, for each team that we've got going on. So let's just dive straight in. First one. So we're going to go for the big one. The big one of the two de facto leaders of each respective team. You got the outfits, Ted O'Keefe, who's more the mouthpiece, more the guy who leads his charge, the charges into action. Ted O'Keefe taking on Zach Dynamite, a former Tri-Counties champion, a former Regal Rumble winner, a former Undisputed WrestleZone champion. He has got accolades out the wazoo. He's won just about everything in WrestleZone, bar the tag team titles, which are held by Bruiser Brad and Ryan Riley. So there's not a freebird rule, but you know, it's part of the Foundation of the Future. He's got those tag team titles in hand. So this really heated up from Battle of the Nations, as we've talked about, and it really became because of the Tri-Counties Championship match between Caleb Valhalla and Zach Dynamite. Zach Dynamite came in defending that title at Station Hotel, in the Station Hotel for Battle of the Nations, and it looked like that Caleb was on his way to victory. Zach had called in his boys, called in Evans and Riley, and they were soon followed by the outfit. During all the melee, the distraction, as you saw in the footage, that we will provide some footage. We've got some footage in here that we're going to throw in on the end of the match, which we'll show you in a second. Zach tried to use the Tri-County Championship. Ted O'Keefe swooped in, grabbed the belt off Zach Dynamite, which led to Caleb Valhalla stinging him with a massive spear and finishing off the bout with the Hell Rider, becoming the new WrestleZone Tri-County Champion. So not only has the outfit feel disrespected by Foundation of the Future because of their words about them as a team and not being almost like not worthy enough to be going after the tag team championships and the Foundation of the Future, they've struck first blood. Is that the phrase? Drawn first blood. So they've got one up on the Foundation of the Future by taking away the Tri-County Championship from the trio. So this whole outfit versus the Foundation of the Future is going to be a very heated affair. And this is just this is the opening chapter. We're going to possibly see. I don't know. I would have to wait until something's official is announced. But we'll possibly see a showdown between the two teams at Hijinks or Christmas Chaos. So this is the opening gambit. There's three matches. Someone's going to possibly get an advantage, whether it's 3-0, 2-0, or 2-1, or maybe it's my brain's thinking that possibly one of the matches may not end with a deciding fall. So there's a lot that could happen on this night. But Ted O'Keefe and Zach Dynamite, I think that's going to be a very interesting one to keep an eye on. So let's look at the other two.
Let us reintroduce ourselves. We are The Outfit. And let me take you back to Station Hotel, where the Foundation Boys had a few choice words for the tag team division. And they had a few choice words for The Outfit, which some of us may or may not have taken a wee bit personally.
Riley, you want to insult me? I can maybe look past it. You're going to insult my boys too? If you're throwing the first stone, then we're throwing the first fist. Now, Inverurie, you boys can take who you want, but Riley, you're mine.
So, Murphy wants Riley, Ted has that. Who does that leave? Oh, yes. Bradley Evans. Oh, sorry. The Bruiser. The Mad Dog. The Showstopper. Yeah! Well, guess what, Bradley? Doesn't matter what personality or what era of you want to go with, when you step into the ring with Dino, there's only one thing you're going to be looking at. You're going to be looking at me, and then the lights, my friend.
Yes, and as Dino mentioned there, it is official. Zach Dynamite versus Ted O'Keefe. And unlike Station Hotel, Zach, where you tried to cheat your way to a win, that's not going to happen this time, because the Foundation Boys, your days are numbered. If you want to cheat and bully your way to the top, The Outfit ain't going to stand for it no more. Because it's time for the Foundation of the Future to be left in the past.
So Murphy and Ryan Riley are also matched up in this particular feud that we've got going on. There's been a lot of back and forth between the two teams. A lot of words, a lot of war of the words that we're going to try and put in to this episode so you can hear and see what's going down in the world of The Outfit versus The Foundation in the Future. And as this is very new, not only very new for this kind of arc of The Foundation versus The Outfit, but also very new to see The Outfit being cheered as well, because they've never been cheered, or not on purpose anyway. They've always been quite sneering towards the WrestleZone fans, and to have them now, it's not even the case they're acting on behalf of the WrestleZone fans. They're just acting on behalf of the tag teams in WrestleZone. They're acting on behalf of themselves, being disrespected by the Foundation, and the world doesn't end with the Foundation in the Future as tag team champions forever. They're a team that have had opportunities, and they've been very close as well. There was a Battle of the Nations pre-pandemic that we had Scotty Swift and Johnny Lyons as the tag team champions at the time, both now retired. Both now retired from WrestleZone. I know Johnny is still active down in Fife, as well as a little bit here and there when he comes out of a time machine. I think he is actually supposed to be retiring this year again, but that's not a story for this podcast. So they were very close to being tag team champions. They even had a winning pinfall over Johnny Lyons and Scotty Swift as well, but there was shenanigans. It was ruled a restart, and they unfortunately had the tag team titles ripped away from them at that moment in time. So they've had chances, and they've achieved it, but it's not been recorded. They haven't officially achieved the accolade of tag team champions. And since when Ted went away after Summerhill Showdown, after that big brawl, and Murphy was brought in and Ellen, these two have been just a force, and they've been kind of put in the back burner a lot of the time. They've been used as brutes. They've been used as the Sterling Brothers' muscle. They've been used as Captain Allen specifically as muscle, and they've been about. They've been doing things. They've been leathering people, but they haven't really been given a fair shake at tag team titles. And while the Foundation were being champions, they didn't really get that much of a look in because they weren't fan favorites. People didn't want to see them going for the tag team titles because it would be hiding into nothing. It was either going to be the Outfit or the Foundation that were going to be tag team champions, and they're both bad guys, both bad teams. So both bad teams in the respect of the fan reaction. So now that they've not only embraced a crowd, they've realized that the Foundation are the bad guys. They're the big bad. They're the big boss. They're the team that needs to be defeated. And they're going to try and use some encouragement from the WrestleZone faithful to try and get those tag titles eventually. This isn't about that, though. Murphy and Ryan Riley, though, this match, I think this could be a little bit, I think this might surprise people. We've got the match with Ted and Zach, which will be a bit of a lighter footed affair because they're smaller guys. They've got a little bit more to play with in that respect. But Murphy and Ryan Riley, they're the possibly underappreciated part of their respective factions. Because Murphy, I know I joke about him, when you look at him, always saying it's Murphy, 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 and that is the case. But to see him improve immediately since he joined the Outfit has been incredible. He's kind of grown into his own skin. He's pulled himself up. He's able to be part of the Outfit, and the confidence he's grown from that is absolutely evident. And seeing Ryan, obviously the inspirational one, he's had a huge news of his own in his real life and outside of wrestling life. Wrestling's real. So outside of that, so he's got that in the back of his brain. Maybe he's got that to think about when he's wrestling Murphy. There's so many things that could happen in this match, and this is why I think this is going to be a very interesting one. I think when you look at Ted and Zach, you think Zach. Zach's got the accolades. He's got the experience. He's got all that. And that's not a slight against Ted. That's just looking at it logistically, you know? And then we'll look at the third match in a moment. But that match is two big bruiser guys. You know, it's going to be just survival of the fittest. It's going to be King Kong versus Godzilla, you know? This one's the interesting one because Ryan is very cerebral in his antics. He picks his spots. He picks all the right moments to get involved in matches. He had a great banger with Aspen at Station Hotel Showdown at the start of the year, I think it was. Yeah, start of the year. And it showed that he's not just a tag team guy. He didn't win that match, but it just showed he wasn't just a tag team guy and he can be cerebral and in his own respect. And he got Murphy. Murphy, possibly the quiet one. Like I say, his confidence has grown since joining the Outfit. But he's a guy that... He's very explosive when he gets going. I saw that at Trinity Center. I've seen that in respective matches. When he gets going, he can be a very explosive individual in the ring. So this is going to be a very intriguing match. Let's look at the third one.
Me and my boys are going... Boys? What are you doing over there? What the hell? All right. I thought we'd do it down there.
Why?
Bro, that's what the Outfit did.
They were miles behind Ted.
Why did you do that?
He smells really bad.
You mean like the front row wrestlers on crowds?
Exactly.
Anyway, as I was saying, Outfit, me and my boys
I've got something we need to get off our chest.
Murphy, the best thing I ever did for you was speaking your name. Instantly, your credibility rose through the roof because I took a little swipe. You know, I knew I had a problem when I was half of Murphy's weight, but I did something about it. And you come in, try and show that you're Billy Big whatever. Doesn't fly with me, Murphy. You'll get what's coming to you.
Oh, Dino, I'm looking forward to this fight we're gonna have, because the granite road, as they say, is set. We're gonna walk on it, we're gonna dance on it, we're gonna fight on it. And you're getting Bruiser Brad Evans.
The best kind!
No showstoppers!
And no mad dogs!
And as far as Ted O'Keefe goes, the most relevant you've ever been is when you snatched the Tri-Counties title out of my hands, because that's as close to championship gold as you've ever gotten! Now, you have made the biggest mistake of your life. You cost me something that is mine by right! So, Inverurie, Ted, I'm going to make you pay. You're in for the worst night of your life! An outfit you're going to realize! Next to the foundation of the future, you're nothing but two-bit players.
This is the big one, I think. Out of the three, Ted and Zach, I think that's going to be the most intriguing because that's your de facto leaders. Murphy and Ryan Riley is interesting because of their roles in their respective factions and their, and like I said, Ryan's cerebral mind versus Murphy and his explosiveness. I'm rambling. But this one, Dino and Bruiser Brad Evans, two big brutes, two beefy individuals, the Beef King Bruiser Brad, and we've got Dino, who's got that rolling elbow. This is going to be two guys absolutely leathering each other for 5 to 10 minutes until one of them can no longer stand. And if that's not the case, this is the one I think that chaos is going to brew. I don't think this is going to be one that we'll see end in the ring. I think this is going to be one hopeful social club. It's not a big haul. Let's be honest. It's not a big haul. I'll be able to stand up and see the back. So I think this is going to be one where the merch stand's going to be having to be protected. They're going to have Lewis is going to have to go check stand by there. They're going to have additional security possibly. So I wonder who's been drafted from the WrestleZone Training Academy to try and control this one. This is going to be absolute chaos. Is that a word? The absolute chaos match. This is going to be absolute chaotic. Bruiser Brad, Dino. I don't think Inverurie is going to be able to hold that particular match. Coupled with the fact that not only is Bruiser Brad generally an angry person, but he's in his own town. And I don't know if that would cause a factor, but when you go into your hometown to wrestle, you come in with an extra bit of oomph. You come in with a little bit extra spice. You come in with a little bit extra, like, I'm going to show people in my hometown what I can do, and I'm going to absolutely beat the living you know what out of my opponent and show them that I'm the king. I'm the king of Inverurie, and that's possibly may happen. So this is the big one. This is the one that you're going to watch and go, oh my god, this is the poster to SummerSlam 99. This is 98. SummerSlam 98. This is the two Goliaths just battering each other on the granite road, and I think this is going to be one that you're going to have to keep an eye on and to watch and keep your eyes darting all over the place as well when you want to see what's happening. So three huge matches. This is just the start of the outfit versus Kings versus the Foundation of the Future. I don't know why I was going for Kings there. Foundation of the Future. I think this is going to be an absolute wild ride. I don't even know when it's going to stop, whether it's going to go all the way to Aberdeen Anarchy next year. Who knows? But certainly it's going to be kicked off wild in wild fashion in Inverurie at the Hopeful Social Club. Let's take a look at the other matches we've got coming up. We've also got, and you know what? I've talked a lot about those first three matches on the main card, but the back half of this preview, there are three matches that are on the main card. You know what? There is no bad matches. And that's just a fact. You can say what you want about me being a WrestleZone super fan, but I think when you look at the back half, there is some interesting. That's the word I use a lot. Interesting, because it's not matches that you go, this is a dream match. But when you look at it written down, you go, okay, this is going to be interesting. And none more so than Mr. WrestleZone and Mr. Omar Muhammad taking on Ronan King and Captain Alan Sterling. I don't know where to begin with this particular matchup. So let's break it down logistically here from Battle of the Nations. Mr. WrestleZone and Mr. Omar, they lost in a handicap match to Brian Tucker. I mean, thanks in no small part to Rhys Dawkins and also a big book of Shakespeare that caused the defeat. Ronan King, he lost at Battle of the Nations as well, a blindfold match against Damien, a match that was super entertaining. And we had Captain Alan Sterling, who won his match against Deacon Matthews, when he's got a showdown coming up against Damien. Possibly, it's not been confirmed as yet, but he certainly threw out the challenge of Battle of the Nations to Damien so he could take on a pirate. It makes sense when you see it in context, I suppose. So you're coming into this tag team match. Captain Alan is the only one who's coming in with a victory, which is a very odd sentence in itself. Ronan King probably isn't even thinking about this match particularly because he has laid out the challenge to Caleb Valhalla. It was backstage after Caleb won the belt at Battle of the Nations. So he's got that to think about. Whether it will be against Caleb, whether he gets a title match. Again, it's not officially being confirmed. It looks like that's the road that we're going down. So he might not be particularly enthused about being in this matchup. They got Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Muhammad, who got disrespected by Foundation of the Future in that opening promo at the start of the show here. They got disrespected and then they lost in a handicap match when it was 2-on-1. Mr. WrestleZone, he ran off, and this is going to be fun for us as fans in the audience watching the show. This is going to be a lot of fun. But my concern is always going to be about whether Mr. WrestleZone's antics will finally make Omar snap. And when Omar's going to be in a ring with Mr. WrestleZone, who's entertaining, silly, erratic. When he's in a ring with Captain Alan Sterling, who is silly, erratic, just Captain Alan. And then Ronan King, who's cocky, cool, cocky, and bad. He's there to wind up his opponents. Whether it at least his ultimate downfall or whether he gets a victory from it, that's by the by. So Omar Muhammad is standing there with three of the most, I'm going to use the word chaotic. I'm going to use that a lot, I think, of three most chaotic characters in WrestleZone when it comes to personality. And he's going to stand there and try and control Mr. WrestleZone when he tries to get over the top ropes or has his extra long tag rope. He's going to try and concentrate on that and also concentrate against his opponents. It's just... I feel sorry for Omar. That's pretty much the long and short of that big diatribe was I feel sorry for Omar Muhammad. I think his brain is going to have to contend with a lot of things on this night in Inverurie. Last time was Inverurie, he was against Brian Tucker, and Brian Tucker almost died when he flung himself off a ring post to try and escape Omar. So Omar's got a lot of luck in Inverurie, so hopefully it's going to be by his side, but I don't know what's going to happen in this match, and it's going to be very entertaining for us as fans, but I feel like it's going to be the start of something. You know, you get that feeling in your gut that it might something down the line. I don't know. There's just something about this particular match that has me all aflutter and made me go, I think something big is going to happen in this match. I don't know whether it's going to be a boatload of interference. We're going to see Caleb maybe trying to distract Ronan. Whether we're going to see Damien try and distract Captain Alan. Whether we're going to see Brian Tucker and Reece Dawkins again for Mr. WrestleZone Omar. We're going to see Omar snap. We're going to see Mr. WrestleZone wander off somewhere, go to Aldi, or end up in Greg's. I don't know. There's a lot of places nearby at the Hopeville Social Club, so you can easily find him somewhere. I think there isn't like an Aldi or a Lidl across the street. So we don't know where Mr. WrestleZone might end up at the end of the night. So this just makes it all the more intriguing. For people that are going to see WrestleZone for the first time, though, they'll be coming into this going, this is a bit wild, this is a bit silly, this is a bit fun. But for those that are nerds and read a million things into one little moment, this is going to be one that I'm going to just think about for a long time. I'm probably going to think about it all the way to Inverurie while I'm driving there on Saturday as well. So, yeah, I don't know. I no point to the end of that. Let's just look into the next match.
Some men are born great. Some achieve greatness. And others have greatness thrust upon them. William Shakespeare, the 12th Knight. The people of Inverurie will have greatness thrust upon them when Rhys Dawkins makes his way back on September 9th. And I'm facing two men who have achieved greatness. Aspen Faith, the current undisputed champion, and Damien, the man who has more reigns than anyone else in this company. Both men have achieved everything there is to achieve in WrestleZone. But I'm just getting started. I was born great. I am the most intelligent professional wrestler on this side of the globe. And when I defeat two of the most iconic wrestlers in WrestleZone, I will cement my place in this company's future. Mark my words.
The show with the championship match, WrestleZone Tri-County Championship match. So in the meantime, let's look at the triple threat non-title match, which includes Lost Boy Aspen, Damien, and Rhys Dawkins. this, when this match was announced, I looked at it and went, that's a very interesting combination. Because you got Lost Boy Aspen, Undisputed WrestleZone champion, come off victory against Mickey Vago, controversy, aplomb, whatever, we'll show you footage in this episode of what happened. Probably, I don't know. We'll figure it out. So he's coming in, champion, non-title match. Damien may still have one eye. Come off a victory against Ronan King, and he's possibly got a showdown with Calvin Allen Sterling in the near future as well. So both former, Aspen being current, but both undisputed champions, right? Both former tag team champions, for that matter, where we're going at it. I think you got Rhys Dawkins. Now, not saying, I'm not diminishing Rhys's talent at all on this, but Rhys Dawkins is coming back from a broken wrist that he suffered at Aberdeen Anarchy. So he's coming in. He may have had some matches down at the galas. I think he did. I've sort of seen some pictures from Kirsten, from Kirsten Lewis Photography, put up some photos from the galas. So he's had a little bit of in-ring time since coming back from injury, but it's one of those injuries where, and I say this to someone who has broken a bone in their arm, which, you know, close enough. You're never quite the same after that kind of injury. And if it's his dominant hand, then that affects everything pretty much. Strength, picking up, even a little bit of balance as well. So he's coming into a very heavy triple threat match against Aspen, who is just evolving into this big, scary brute of a wrestler. Who's just, there's nothing particularly pretty about his wrestling. He just comes in with hard chops, hard punches, hard kicks, pile drivers, all that kind of stuff. So he's coming in against high impact offense. Then you got Damien, who may not be as heavy in his offense, but he's always got those kicks. He's always got a lot of high impact explosive moveset. So Rhys is coming into this all the confidence in the world, as you should, because if you're not confident in yourself, you're not going to be doing much good in the ring. That's the life as a viewer I've learned. So he's coming in from that wrist injury, and it just makes things, I don't know, he's going to have to pick his spots, really. That's what he's going to have to do. He's going to have to maybe go to Brian Tucker, if Brian some sort of is outside of his lucid dreams of WrestleZone being Scotty Swift, find former undisputed champion Brian Tucker, former tag team champion Brian Tucker, and try and pick his brain on maybe how to survive this kind of match. Because I think if he ends up in the middle of that ring with Damien on one side and Lost Boy Aspen on the other, I worry for Rhys Dawkins. As much as he is a Shakespearean twonk, is that the word? Yeah, we'll go with that. At times, you don't want to see him. Even I would feel sorry for Rhys Dawkins getting absolutely leathered constantly by Damien and Aspen. Even I would feel sorry for him. So that'll be very interesting. It's a very interesting ruffle. And I don't know. Words are just not coming to me today. Very interesting page in this book. So, yeah, so you got a triple threat. Rhys Dawkins lost by Aspen, Damien. As Aspen's got his match with Vago on the 21st of October for Halloween Hijinks, he's coming off a very interesting period where I'm sure I mentioned it in the recap, definitely mentioned it in the Battle of Nations SWM podcast, but there seems to be a little bit of a turning of the tide in the fan reaction to Aspen because he keeps beating people, which is a ridiculous thing. He's getting some murmurs, some not even jeers, but just he's comprehensively beaten favorites, and he's coming into a match with Damien, and Damien is still wholeheartedly one of the most beloved wrestlers in WrestleZone. And I think if Aspen soundly beats Damien in this match, I think that adds, and the disgruntlement will grow, even if though it's non-title. But we saw the reaction from Ronan King stabbed Damien in the eye. People were apoplectic. They were disgusted at Ronan because of that. And so Damien is still a very much a beloved figure. And I think that that makes it just very intriguing in that respect. I could be speaking absolute nonsense. You do know this, right? But he's got his match with Asma's got his match with Vago coming up. There was, I said, controversy, the bottom rope. Vago had his foot on the bottom rope. And there was a lot of discontent in the crowd. They wanted Vago to win, or they wanted Vago to get his resolution there and then, or the what, 5 more minutes. Whereas Aspen came in, he did his job. The referee, they messed up, but it wasn't his fault. And that caused a little bit of scrambling. So it's just, the fan reaction in this match will be very intriguing. There will certainly be Reese. We know that. They'll cheer Damien. Absolutely. But will they cheer or boo Aspen? That's the case. And I don't think it will, because as I've mentioned in previous episodes, Aspen hasn't changed anything. He'll do a couple fist bumps here and there, but he hasn't changed Aspen. He hasn't changed himself in the case of how he reacts to fans. He's still beating people. He's still doing his job as a wrestler. But he's not letting fans distract him, I don't think. I don't think he has. Anyway, he's not letting fans enter his brain space to change any outcome of what he's going to do in that match, you know? So I think the fan reaction will be very interesting in this particular match, and I'm very interested to see what it is. It's a non-title, so there's room for error in Aspen's case, because he's not losing a title in this match, so he's still going to be undisputed wrestling champion when it comes to Halloween hijinks. So whether he takes the match itself seriously, whether he takes it as a wee tune-up for Mickey Vago, that's remains to be seen. So a lot of interesting things coming into this match that I possibly have overread, but you're listening, hopefully, and you can overread into it with me. So let's look at the main event.
The mighty Caleb has got his first Tri-Counties defense at Inverurie, and he faces the Wally, Brian Tucker. What's a Wally? And the heavy metal hooligan, Mickey Vago. Now, I need to get a lock for this door.
Yeah, I've been told I'd find you in here.
Yes, in the middle of something here.
Oh, sorry about that. I thought you'd be ready to go.
Ready to go?
Yeah, pub.
Oh, the public house! Yes! Pub. Where's your war paint?
We're going to the pub. We're going drinking. We're not going to war. We can't get caught fighting in any of our pubs. If we get barred from any of our pubs in Montrose, we'll have nowhere left to drink, Caleb.
All right, let's go. Was your fault.
It wasn't. It was your fault.
I'm blaming you, Vago.
It was your fault. I warned you. I told you this was going to happen.
Well, why'd you get involved?
Because there was 10 of them.
I had it under control. They just looked at me funny.
You were wearing a cape. Of course they looked at you funny.
Oh, my cape! Oh, I must still be there. Well, what is this anyways?
This is what we used to drink about 20 years ago, before we were allowed in the pubs. In the park, like we are now.
Told you I know a place, though.
You did tell me you know a place. But yeah, get that down, you.
What was it? Lemony?
Yeah, it's just as bad as I remember it being.
Yeah. I like it. Lemon! But
speaking of big fights, multi-man fights.
Oh!
Inverurie, we've got one coming up, Caleb.
Yeah, we're getting back into it, hey. You, me, Brian Tucker.
Inspector Tucker.
Inspector?
Inspector Tucker.
And his librarian friend.
And his librarian friend.
Yes.
Reese Dawkins. I'm sure he will be there.
Do I get to beat him up too?
I'm sure we'll probably get him involved.
Yeah.
In some capacity. But just remember, it's not a handicap match. Oh. We're going to have to fight each other at some point.
Yeah, yes. No problem. Brian Tucker as well. He's a former undisputed champion. And the mighty Caleb is the current Tri-Counties champion.
He is.
Yeah.
The championship that I used to have.
Mm-hmm. Mine now.
It is yours, but I'll be coming for that.
That's fine. You win, I win, regardless. We can go out celebrating afterwards.
We can. Because we're not barred from the pubs in Inverurie.
No, no! Yeah! Skull! 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 Skull!
I've said main event, but this is the main event of the preview. Whether it's going to be the last match on the show, I don't know. But it's the WrestleZone Tri-Counties Championship in a triple threat. New champion Caleb Valhalla defends against former champion Mickey Vago, and Brian Tucker is also in this match in this triple threat. Caleb, of course, won a Battle of the Nations to win the title against Zack Dynamite. Mickey Vago, unfortunately, didn't win his match against Aspen in the main event for the Undisputed WrestleZone Championship. We've talked about that quite a bit. You've seen Caleb and Vago's little bit of fun and games a moment ago before we got into this match itself, which I love Caleb's discovery of Midgard. It's wonderful. And we've also got Brian Tucker, who won his match. He won a handicap match against Mr. WrestleZone and Mr. Omar Muhammad. Not without shenanigan, we know this. But he comes into this very interesting. This is some interesting for you. So Brian Tucker was in the original tournament for the WrestleZone Tri-Counties Championship. He made it to the final in Aberdeen Anarchy in that match. It was a four-way ladder match, and he was in with Zach Dynamite, Bingo Balance, and lost by Aspen. So he was so close to becoming the first Tri-Counties champion. Unfortunately, it's not a belt he's lifted since. And he's also, but if he also wins it, he'll be the second ever Grand Slam champion in WrestleZone history as a Regal Rumble winner, tag team champion, and undisputed champion. So he has got a lot to win in this match. Not only the Tri-Counties Championship, but also history. Aspen's the first Grand Slam champion. He's won it all. Brian has a chance to be the second, which, you know, it's still an amazing achievement, especially someone like Brian, who's pretty much been there since year dot in WrestleZone, being able to say he is a Grand Slam champion in WrestleZone, in the company that he's dedicated his career to, his wrestling career to. So he has a lot to win in this match. And yes, recently, Brian Tucker has been a bit of a wall. He has been a wall. And it's possibly diluted his talents, and he's made him a bit more comical. But he's still a former tag team champion, he's still a former undisputed champion, still a former Regal Rumble winner. So Brian Tucker can do this, and he could win this match. Will he? Probably not, but he could. He is If you were only watching WrestleZone the last year, he is super out of place in this match. In a championship match with Caleb, godlike human, Vago, the heavy metal hooligan, and then Brian Tucker, who's spent his last year getting tied up in knots thanks to Scotty Swift, Omar Hamid, and then more recently Mr. WrestleZone. So you look at that and you think, Brian Tucker's got no chance. But his accolades say that he has every chance of winning that match. And he may have Reese in tow. If he's got Reese Dawkins with him, that's two in his favour. I don't want to get into sacrifice Scott Steiner math, but, you know, he's got, if there's two of them there, and triple threats are no DQ, you know, it could work. And Mickey Vago coming in, let's see, he's got that match with Aspen at Halloween Hijinks, so could make it a champion versus champion match if he wins. And also former Tri-Counties champion, former tag team champion. He's never won a Regal Rumble, but you know, this is all still working towards the possibility of a triple crown at Halloween Hijinks if he wins the Tri-Counties Championship again, going into that match as a champion versus champion. That makes it even more sweeter if he is the one that wins at Halloween Hijinks, and he can hold both titles aloof, aloft. Yeah, I'm too tired for this. Hold both titles aloft to like Ultimate Warrior. So there's a lot to play for in that particular scenario for Mickey Vago. Caleb Valhalla, first defense of the title, and what a moment when he won it. There was Not a dry high, a dry, not a dry eye in the house. Not a bum on a seat. We're all ecstatic to see Caleb Valhalla become WrestleZone Tri-Counts champion. And immediately afterwards, went backstage with that belt, and Ronan King was there, immediately challenging him for Halloween hijinks. So Caleb needs to get past this challenge first. But if we're going to get Caleb versus Ronan at Halloween hijinks, oh, that's an opportunity. That's a potential that I want to see. I want to see happen, because that's a match that I think will be absolutely incredible for me as a fan to see at Halloween hijinks. Amazing. So, interesting. Triple threat. Interesting is the word I use a lot here. Interesting. Intrigue. Chaotic. That seems to be my buzzwords here on the WrestleZone podcast. But we've got a six match card on the main card, but pre-show match as well. And this is a really stacked lineup for WrestleZone. For those that are fans, those that want to jump in and see WrestleZone for the first time that may not have or may have not been in a while, this is a really, really strong card to jump into and see as we're on the road to Christmas Chaos and Halloween Hijinks, Christmas Chaos. And then that gets into the new year where we see Station Hotel Showdown and Regal Rumble and all that kind of good stuff towards Arcade Anarchy. A lot of interesting prospects, and I'm so excited to see this show on Saturday. I'm absolutely buzzing for it. Let's wrap this up. So as I told you at the start there, WrestleZone Live in Inverurie, 9th of September 2023. It's sold out at the Hopeville Social Club in Inverurie. Keep an eye on WrestleZone socials for a possibility of some tickets being available, or because you gotta get to this show. If you're wanting to see this outfit and foundation in the future start to blow up, get onto this show. It's Inverurie. It's not that difficult to get to from Aberdeen, I don't think. It's about an hour or so drive for me, so it's not that far away, and there's a Greggs, so I win all over the place. So there's a lot on this show, a lot to enjoy, a lot to take in, and I think this is going to be another absolute banger of a show from WrestleZone. And if you haven't got your ticket yet, unfortunately, like I said, keep an eye on the socials, but if you have got your ticket, I can't wait to see it. Can't wait to see you there. I'm hoping to maybe grab some people for some interviews at the show. So hopefully we'll either be on the recap, or you have to keep an eye out for the WrestleZone Halloween hijinks. What was it? The Inverurie. What have I called the episode? I think I've just called the SWN podcast Inverurie because I'm clever, which only translates in writing. So you'll get to see more of that. You'll get to see the recap next week. And like I say, we'll have a bit more in our SWN podcast. But this has been the WrestleZone podcast. I can't wait for the show. As you can see, I'm all flutter because I'm buzzing for it. I want to go see some wrestling. This is it. It's gonna be a great show. So go see it. If you can't go to the show, however, like I said, we'll have our recap on Monday or Tuesday. And from that, also keep an eye on wrestling show socials for some video footage and some photos. Kirsten Louise Photography will no doubt have some photos up. So keep an eye out there for some photography, etc. And we'll have some footage somewhere as well. I'm going to try and litter some footage in with this episode. It'll probably be horrifically edited, but you know, I'm trying. So have a good one, folks. I'll see you Saturday. And let's just do it. Inverurie, let's go.
Now I've got both my eyes back, I'm looking at exactly what I want.
Name the time.
Halloween!
Yeah, let's do it. Bring it.
Let's bring it, boy.